98.9 WTRH. The truth. If you're not listening to the truth, then it's false. The Thursday Thursday podcast.
Why can't I fire you?
Because I'm your wife. You can't fire me. We in this together.
I want the truth. You can't handle the truth.
What is up, good people? You are tuned in again to season 4 of the Thursday Thursday podcast titled In Sickness and in Health, where we are exploring topics of health and the impact it can have on relationships and how we cope. Mm-hmm. And this is episode 3, where we call Navigating Menopause, a Silent Transition. And I am so excited. I'm excited, but I have to bring myself down.
Okay. Just a little.
Because last week I was so excited with Coach Sam. When me and Enrique went to edit it, I was like, you know,
super loud, off the charts.
Well, sometimes my brain and my mouth don't work together. So,
is there menopause for men?
I don't know, like, man. But like I'm trying to say 15 words. I'm like, man, that didn't make sense. I sound crazy. So I'm just trying to calm down.
Okay.
Oh my God.
I'm excited.
We got your back. Yes.
But I'm just trying to be easy here.
All right.
So we have a great, great guest.
Yes.
But before we do that, just remember, you can, because I didn't do our call to order anything. I don't tell people where to find us. So remember, you can find us mm-hmm. every Sunday at 4 o'clock. On ITK Community Radio, mm-hmm. Two Hearts Inspiration and Fun. That's our gospel show. Mm-hmm. You can find us on IG and Facebook, The Two Hearts, and on Twitter X.
I'm like, what's the X one? See, I don't know anything about social
media. MSTAJ _HARK.
Okay.
All right. So this episode of the Thursday Thursday podcast is brought to you by
none other than Sons of S.P. Phillips.
Sons of S.P.
Yes.
Phillips.
You can visit them at www.sonsofspphillips.com. Sons of S.P. Phillips is an online boutique with new and slightly used designer and name brand clothing and apparel for men and women. Sons of S.P. Phillips also has custom restyle fedora and brim hats, custom t-shirts, and other custom accessories.
Right.
You can also follow Sons of S.P.P. on
Instagram and Facebook at Sons of SPP, and on Twitter at
Okay, he got it.
Sons of SPP.
So go there and you will find items up to 70% off.
Right. And they just extended their discount of 35% off on items, and any purchases over $45, free shipping.
Free shipping.
Free
what?
Shipping. Right.
All right.
Now, I did it again because I'm so excited. I forgot to say, I'm your host, the H Double Heart Henry.
You said it last time, didn't you?
Yeah, and this is the Superstar.
Your Lady the Her.
Your Lady the Her. Now.
Now.
We are
ready.
We are ready and excited to have this guest. It's a long time coming.
Yes. Come on now, introduce our guest.
Go ahead and introduce yourself.
Oh.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Donna G, MD, your gyne guru, and I'm all about menopause.
Oh,
okay.
Hello, Dr. Donna. How are you today?
I'm well, and it has been a long time coming. I'm so happy to be here with you guys today.
I'm so excited to have you. I want to give everybody some backstory on how me and Dr. Donna met.
Okay.
So, it's going to be a little podcasting 101 here on a couple of things here. So I signed up for a podcast seminar. It was mm-hmm. an online seminar. And there was a lot of networking going on. And me and Dr. Donna met. And we kind of went, you know, we were in some of the rooms. And she asked if she wanted to be. She asked to be on our podcast. Actually, she's the reason why we're doing Sickness and Health.
Well, thank you. Thank
yes.
you.
Oh, wow.
So she's the reason for this whole season.
Okay.
So here's the podcast 101. So when she said, I'm a doctor, I do menopause, and I was like, I don't know how to fit you in. But, you know, as a creative content, a creator of content, you have to think outside the box mm-hmm. at times. So it's okay This is for you know, our podcast listeners who might be listening. It's okay to tell somebody, hey, you might not be able to fit in, or hey, let's work something out. So with her being a medical doctor, I said, well, you know what? Sickness and in health, I can't work that into our relationship, or, you know, topics. Yeah. So this is where we are. But with somebody, don't be so stressed out to have to make content or try to get so many listeners that you're just sticking somebody in there. So somebody who wants to talk about sports, I wouldn't put them on here.
Okay.
Right.
We want substance.
Yes. You want substance. And you want somebody to fit and that's going to make your content flow and your pot, and it's going to work with your podcast. And the other part of this podcast 101, me and Dr. Donna was going back and forth. We were arm wrestling a little bit.
Do tell.
But she taught me.
Okay. So thank you for teaching
them. You're welcome.
Yes. So we were working out the release form and the contract, and she let me know there was some wording that she wasn't okay with, but she pointed out some things that I didn't know.
Okay.
So it's about, it's always about protecting your rights as a guest, as a host, and the podcast. So again, Podcast 101 for anybody listening or anybody else, any business at all, protect yourself. And if you're doing business with anybody, make sure you're looking over the contract where you're protecting yourself and, you know, both entities involved.
Okay.
All right. So I thank you, Dr. Donna.
You're welcome.
For that. And I believe when you learn from the people in your community, your culture grows.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Words of wisdom.
So, Dr. Donna, give us a brief summary of your background, because you are a actual medical doctor.
That's right.
As my friend, the rocket scientist aunt, said, I'm a real doctor. He has a PhD in physics, and I met his great aunt one time because we went to college together. And she was like, oh, she's a real doctor. I born and raised in Florida, went to college as an engineer, believe it or not. So I went to Hopkins. I graduated in engineering, worked in engineering for AT&T for a hot minute. Didn't like the career path. Loved the job. Didn't like the career path. So I went back to school and went to medical school. So I went to Emory for training in medical school, as well as residency in OBGYN. I've practiced in a lot of places. I used to do locums, which is the doctor that fills in for other doctors. And I just did that, to be honest, because I was so worn out and depressed after my residency. I couldn't afford to quit because I had loans. So it allowed me to kind of just not have responsibility other than be a hired gun. And so I practiced in Hawaii. I practiced in St. Croix. I've been in Oregon. I've been in places, very small towns. In Georgia, where Sunday afternoon I was asked to stay so that they could come see a black doctor after church. People came to the hospital just to see me, just to see that a black doctor existed. So I've done a lot of private practice, though. So my last 20 years was private practice. Some on St. Croix and most here in my home county, in Brevard County, Florida. And let me tell you, small town private practice was what I was meant to do. It was phenomenal.
Let me ask you a question, because that's a lot of schooling. So, how do you go from being an engineer to just like, I'm gonna be a doctor?
That's a whole podcast. I got to medical school, and I went to the Hopkins. I went to a place that's a pre-med factory, and when I tell you how I trashed my classmates who were pre-med, because I mean, literally, they were like biology majors or whatnot. I was like, what kind of job are you going to get with that? They were like, we're just here to go to med school. I'm like, oh, I would never do that.
Right.
I went as a biomedical engineer, and except for maybe 6 or 8 credits, my curriculum had all the prerequisites for med school. I had no intention of going to med school, but I had intended to go to college to be a PhD and do research. And I was there a couple of months, maybe by the second semester, I was like, I won't be doing any research. And so I knew that my initial plan was not what I was going to do. And I've never been one to close doors. So by the time I finished, I could take the MCATs. I don't even think I had to pay for them. And so I just took the MCATs my senior year. I had the requirements. I'm like, what the heck?
Yeah.
Right. I had a job that was going to require me in engineering to go do a master's degree. And my thought was, if I love the job, then I've already got the master's degree built in. Mm-hmm. If I don't love the job, I've got a year to figure it out. And ultimately, the job was fabulous. The people were fabulous. The career was not. Mm-hmm. I was far more interested in volunteering in the NICU than the AT&T card that was going to come out 8 years from now.
Right.
And so it was a fabulous experience, but med school fit my personality.
Right.
Okay.
It fit that I wanted to be around people more and whatnot. And so on that sense, it was a no regrets. It was a great choice. I just didn't appreciate how emotionally devastating and spiritually devastating training could be.
Yeah.
Right. Let me throw this nugget in there, because this is something that we touched on in our first episode. Mm-hmm. We touched on it with Coach Sam in our last episode about people of color in our community going to doctors and not how we don't go to the doctor because we don't feel like we're getting the best care.
Yep.
And even Coach Sam touched on medical racism. And being a woman of color, and you said in a small town, I bet that had like the craziest impact for those people, because I bet a lot of those people didn't go to the doctor or didn't even have a doctor to go to or have someone to trust.
It's a huge impact, but you know, we live in a racist country, so people bring their outlook and their attitudes and their behavior patterns with them wherever they go. Mm-hmm. We have that same degree of racism in everything that we do. If you go to an attorney, if any of that.
Right.
What struck me, I never was surprised that I was the first Black doctor. Mm-hmm. That people saw, white, Black, or otherwise.
Right.
Okay. What floored me was I was the first female doctor almost everywhere I went.
Oh, wow.
Until I went to St. Croix. I was the first female doctor most of my patients in all that traveling time had ever had. Even when I came here and I'm in my home county, for many of them, I was their first female doctor. That always surprised me. Because I was spoiled. I was in Atlanta. I was around Black female doctors, Black male doctors, female doctors. I was around a very diverse population in an urban setting of physicians. Right. And a majority of physicians in the country are still white. Mm-hmm. But when you talk about the experienced private practice folk, it is still very much a white male dominated profession.
Yeah.
And if you're in smaller towns, smaller communities, you don't get choices in terms of who you go to. And so the behavior pattern that the reputation of that doctor has, because people talk. I never advertised. I was 14 and a half years in private practice. Advertised one time.
Wow.
Because all the patients, your patients are going to go tell people what the experience was like, good, bad, or otherwise.
Yeah.
And there's so much of that. I'm going to do a lot of speaking and social media stuff talking about medicine. And yes, there's all this racism and there's horrible stuff, but we're scaring more people away from care. And we have to moderate that, because what ends up happening, we wait till the very last minute until we can't stand it anymore. And then we get bad care. And then it's even a bigger disaster.
And
if we start taking the bull by the horn, so to speak, and get serious about our wellness, get serious about the early stages of whatever's going on, so that we don't need the level of care that makes us feel so vulnerable.
Right.
Does that make sense?
It does.
You know, so that's a big thing because, you know, you've seen all these women that want to deliver at home now. It's like, y'all have no idea. It is not an Instagram world.
Right. Like what you see in the movie. It's not that. Right. No.
And a lot of those people are lying. They are choosing what they show you. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so many folks are like, oh, I'm going to get a doula and I'm going to deliver at home. What the hell? I'm sorry. I'm not supposed to curse on you, but I'm so sorry.
That's okay. Real love, real life, yes. Real talk. We're so good.
In my OB days, I had several patients that rolling up from disasters at home to the emergency room, and I'm the doc on call. And one particular patient, I was in the middle of emergencies with another patient, and she rolled in expecting that everything was going to stop because there was this literally three-day disaster.
Wow.
Oh.
That she was having at home with a lay midwife who obviously did not accompany her to the hospital. And guess what? She had to wait.
Mm. Wow.
And so there's a lot of stuff. There are a lot of points of view. And I get accused of, oh, well, you're downplaying the racism. I don't downplay the racism. But if you get stopped by a police officer, you know what the real deal is and what not. And and so that's a societal change as much as anything else. So I'm not going to not get care.
Right.
Right.
Because I'm scared. I mean, you know, COVID was the thing for me.
Yeah.
I'm not going to get that shot. I'm like, let me be honest. The rich white people are getting the shot. Come on now.
Yeah.
Tuskegee was about withholding care. And this shot is available to everybody in the early stages. Mm-hmm. I mean, you make your choices, but make them for the right reasons with a level of good information.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
About what's going on. That's my thing. I've had patients that delivered at home. I don't have a problem with that. Look, you don't need me for most delivery. Mm-hmm. But if it goes bad, you better daggone sure have me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
Right. Right.
And especially since we have this zero tolerance for mamas dying and babies dying. If you guys knew how much folks are home scared instead of getting care, there are plenty of bad doctors out there, but the majority are not.
Right.
Mm-hmm. There are plenty of bad doctors that are doing the wrong thing, and that has some impact. But women are not, especially Black women, they're already hypertensive. Mm-hmm. Okay? I mean, there's so much going on with us physically and physiologically by the time we're 25.
Facts.
Yeah. And so we're high risk for a lot of things coming out of the gate.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so you can't sit and look on Instagram at the skinny upper middle class white woman who's never had to be stressed in her life, having a baby in a pool in her room at her house, and decide that you have the same perspective, that you have the same risk, and therefore you're going to do that because you think you want to do that.
Right.
You know?
Yep.
Right.
I'm big on herbals. I'm big on hormones. I did it all. I loved having a bunch of tools in my tool belt, especially with menopause. Mm-hmm. Especially with menopause. But a lot of that I had already started early in my career when I first got exposed to the notion of alternative medicine. Mm-hmm. And being open to the fact that life has different outlooks and different people, and people like different things or are willing to do different things. So how am I best able to help as many women as possible in a manner that they feel good about? So when we start talking about culturally competent care,
right,
meet the woman where she's at.
Right.
And that opens the ability to have more extended care options, because if you trust that I'm looking out for you and I'm very clear on what your options are, I always tell my patients options. Mm. all of their options. I didn't just limit their options. Oh, this is the crunchy, chewy herbal lady, so I'm only going to tell her about herbal stuff. No. All my patients got all their options. Mm-hmm. And when there was an option to choose, I gave them as many choices as they could have, as we could have. But I resisted the patient's notion of coming in. This is the only thing that I'm interested in doing. I need you to be open to maybe that isn't the best option. Or if we do that, this is the time frame I need to see improvement, blah, 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 blah. These are the options I have if that's not working.
Right.
Oh, you've been doing that for 6 months. That's not working. Mm-hmm. This right. is what we have. You know, that's how you have that conversation.
Right.
You know,
right.
And I loved that approach. I was very individual with my approach with patients, and they appreciated that. And then if things weren't working, they didn't hesitate to come back in a very timely manner mm-hmm. so that we could sit down and talk about what do we need to do next.
Right.
And then they've heard all the other tools in my tool belt that I had available to me. And so it wasn't the first time they're hearing these things.
Right. I think the last doctor, the nurse practitioner I saw for my head, she kind of approached it like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The doctor before that, he didn't. He was just like, what's wrong? This, and kind of just pushed me out the door. But then we came back after the MRI. She kind of like went through
options, explained what they were seeing in the MRI.
Yeah.
It was just a very comfortable conversation. And she produced, like you just talked about, different options that we could try. And right now we're trying some things and we're going to follow up if it's not working. So that's the kind of care I was expecting to get from the first visit. But now I'm glad that we've moved over to the nurse practitioner who was, you know, she's still talking to the doctor, but her delivery and explanation of things was more of what I wanted, you know, for him. So,
because even she said, oh, doctor, whatever his name was, she said he can be a little shut off or abrasive. And so I'm sitting thinking to myself, like, well, then what is he? Why is he a doctor?
Because
he wasn't making me feel good about anything.
I had a GI issue at one point, and I had to have a colonoscopy, and one of my colleagues, he got to be the most abrasive person you ever want to meet. I didn't walk into the doctor's lounge. Donna, you're getting fat. I was like, Elliot, shut up. Did I ask you that question?
Wow.
I mean, I understand the doctor's lounge is a no holds barred kind of place.
Right. Kind of like the teachers thing at school.
Oh, when I was a teacher. Oh, yeah.
Let me tell you, the physician lounge, all, you know, because we could be ourselves.
Yeah.
But that was him. The best damn doctor. When I had a GI issue, I had no qualms going to him because he knew his stuff. Right. Now, I have another doctor who similarly has no bedside manner. But he's into research. He's into stuff. But he had sense enough to have a nurse practitioner in his practice to do the touchy feely stuff.
Yeah.
I get the benefit of his expertise with her touchy feeliness. Mm-hmm. But I didn't need that because I wanted the individual interaction. Not every person that goes to med school is an extrovert.
Yeah.
Not every person is going to be somebody who wants to interact on a face-to-face basis with a bunch of strangers every day.
Right.
You know, people have personalities. Doctors actually have their own personalities. How do we set things up?
I
know some of them you think don't have any personality. I get
that. Right.
But how do you set things up to get the best experience for the patient, you know, to get the care that needs to be delivered. And that's hard, especially in private practice, where the physician may be under the gun to make the money. They don't have time to do all that talking. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah.
It's hard. Private practice is hard. I don't miss private practice. I miss my patients. I don't miss the struggle. And the struggle wasn't the scheduling. The struggle wasn't the patient. The struggle was having an ability to be reimbursed for my time and effort in a way that doesn't kill me, that doesn't destroy my spirit. Mm-hmm. And that's what's happening in private practice right now. And it was happening a little bit, and COVID, man, when folks start turning on doctors and accusing them of stuff and acting like crazy people over COVID, that's why you're seeing doctors that are just done. Mm-hmm. I didn't do all that training. I didn't go through all that to help people to be treated like this and to have no life and to actually not even have any decent amount of money. So there's a lot going on. And if the system isn't going to collapse and we lose it all, there need to be some changes. And so I'm going to be a part of that as well. But boy, let me tell you, it's an uphill battle right now just to keep folks practicing. And I know I sound like a hypocrite, but I got sick. But I was like, when I got out, when I started getting better, I was like, I'm not coming back to private practice. I can do more. I have better reach. I can get more things done without the burdens of private practice.
And I totally understand that, because when I worked in, the classroom, I wasn't a teacher. I was an assistant for a long time, but I ran mentor programs, and then I worked with the recreation and park departments for a long time. And it just, sometimes you just feel like, you know, you're putting your best effort forward and you don't feel appreciated, or people are talking to you. One, especially as a teacher, they want to blame you for everything. Look, I'm doing what I can. And then, you know, you just get to the point like, you know what? I can do bad all by myself. I'll step away from this and go do something else and come back in a different capacity.
Right.
And so when you say, yeah, I'm not going back to private practice. And when you say, yeah, I sound like a hypocrite. No, I understand that, because That's kind of where I am now. Cause like I said, I miss the work. I don't miss being in the classroom, but I miss my friends. I miss the work that we used to do, the impact that we had on the children. Mm-hmm. So I'm kind of getting back into that space where trying to figure out where I can get my foot back into that door, to where I can offer something to the community in some way, fashion, or form. So
without
just
being
kinda, right. If it's behind the scenes, or if it's just and I've been doing it dabbles here, but nobody knows about it. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, when I get in these conversations with, people from my hometown, because we're always getting into something, I'm like, man, you don't know my resume. You don't know anything that I've done or what I'm doing currently. Mm-hmm. And the person sitting next to you does, because I did it for them. So, I totally understand what you're talking about. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I want to say it was a difficult decision, but it wasn't, because that decision came out of my spirit. I was just like, you know, you got to take a different path. You got to take a detour away from this. And it was already coming. But it me having neglected health over the years, in terms of neglecting the prioritization of it and things like that, made everything really kind of come to a crashing halt. And then menopause started kicking in, and boy, menopause will blow everything up. Whatever's going on, menopause is going to blow it up.
It's like, it's just like a menopause moment. It'll just change everything, won't it?
That's why when we first started talking, he's like, I'm not sure I know how I would incorporate y'all. I was like, are you married? Like, you cannot know, but I know.
It's coming.
Well, before we get to that menopause moment, let's get our moment in shoes in. So, Dr. Donna, since you are our guest, Dr. Donna, I'm gonna tell you right now, I love you already.
I love you guys. Yeah. I want to come back.
Oh, and then as a side note, I have family moving to Orlando. Is that anywhere near Brevard County?
Yeah, it's like 45 minutes.
Are you accepting new patients?
Brevard County, Kissimmee is only like 30 minutes.
Are you accepting new patients? It's a grandmother and an aunt that'll
remember,
be looking.
Remember, I don't practice anymore.
Oh, I thought you said not private.
I don't practice anymore at all. No, I'm not in clinical medicine anymore.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Well, then never mind.
Pay attention to the guests.
I was paying attention.
We can talk about some referral folks, but
No, I assumed that it was just like at a hospital, not a private practice. So that's my bad. Okay.
Oh, no, I'm a terrible employee. Horrible.
I'm proud to say, horrible.
Employee.
I understand that too.
So is somebody to my right.
It is what it is.
Got a life to live. Don't live to work.
Oh, hey. All right, let's get to these shoes.
All right, what you wearing, Dr. Donna? Let me see your shoes. What you got on today?
These I am known for.
Ooh.
I don't even know what that is hanging on the bottom, but you see I wear them. See, let me get off the bottom there.
Ooh.
My purple clogs.
So okay. Are clogs really comfortable? I've heard they are, but I do not own a pair.
Yes, but I started wearing clogs probably towards the end of medical school after being in a 8 or 9 hour surgery and I could barely walk.
Okay.
My back was hurting so bad. And so I ended up just going someplace and I found some purple suede Zen clogs, the original authentic Swedish clogs. And I never looked back after that.
Okay.
That's my third set in 26 years. This is my third set. And I love them. I love them. I love the support. My first two sets were operating shoes. That's what I wore in the OR. The staff knew me. Everybody knew me with my purple clogs. I wore them in labor and delivery. I made sure they were covered up so they didn't get all gooped up. And those are my shoes.
Well, purple's my favorite color.
And purple is my favorite color.
Dr. Donna's family.
That's right. That's right.
So the her passed me her shoes. She has a thing about Air Force Ones.
All right now.
So her crispy white Air Force Ones with the little metal Air Force One check swooshes.
I love it.
Yeah, that's her life.
I love it.
Life of sneakerheads over here.
I love
me, it. Me, I'm your Jordan man.
See?
Yeah.
I love Celtic
greens. Gotta have them.
Oh my God.
Yes.
You guys are too funny.
Yeah.
I'm a football baby. Preseason. Everybody's like, oh, well, is it football season? I said, it's always football season.
What's your team?
We're either in season, it's postseason, or it's preseason. Come on now.
What's your football team?
The Ravens.
Is that good or bad? Because he's a 49ers fan.
So it's been a long road. I don't remember not having football in my life because my dad was a serious football fanatic.
Okay.
And so growing up, it was the Cowboys and the Raiders. And so I stayed with the Cowboys because my dad's from Texas.
Okay.
Then I spent all those years in Atlanta. You know, Tampa Bay came around, so we added that to the list. And then I spent all those years in Atlanta. But I went to college in Baltimore.
So
that's where my allegiances are these days. You can be shaking your head all you want.
I'm like, he's shaking.
Lamar got something for y'all. This is his time. Do y'all see the fire in his eye?
Do you see the fire?
At least the last half of the season.
I might make you a distant cousin. Because,
I don't care. I'll be an in-law.
Hey. We saw y'all once and y'all got that win. But the 49ers, we might see y'all in the Super Bowl.
Y'all might. Yeah. We hope that we're going to see y'all in the Super Bowl.
We getting that dub. I don't care.
Y'all, come on.
We getting it.
Come on.
So, I'm just letting you know.
Did you all see the difference in how the Ravens played at halftime versus the first half? When Lamar went in there and took his belt off, y'all playing with the wrong person this year.
Distant cousin.
Uh-oh. I'm neutral.
I've been saying to my friends, Lamar, those guys on that team are afraid of Lamar. Lamar is running that team this year. And they're scared of him being unhappy. Go back and watch that.
Okay.
Right. They came out playing like nobody.
Y'all gotta get by. Y'all gotta get by the Kansas City Taylor Swifts next week. Tomorrow. So if y'all get by the Taylor Swifts, then we'll
drop the ball. Drop the ball. Jadarius Toney lined up. Can't even see the ball. He's so offside. Yeah, okay.
Oh, Dr. Don, I tell you.
All right, let's play nice. Let's bring it back. Let's bring it back.
All right. Go ahead with your menopause.
All
put
right,
Dr. Donna pause.
Oh my goodness.
I can't. All right, we're going to get started on this menopause discussion. We're playing nice.
Yes.
All right. So, Dr. Donna.
Yes, ma'am.
Could you provide our listeners with just a brief overview, explanation of what menopause is?
And when it's all said and done, menopause is the end of fertility. You run out of eggs.
Okay.
The cells that make the eggs, the cells that release the eggs, not make the eggs, that release the eggs, are the ones that produce all of these high levels of hormones. And those levels are high because that's what's needed to sustain the cycle for fertility. That's why women have cycles. We hit puberty, we start our cycle, because we're releasing an egg every month to be in a position to get pregnant. When there are no more eggs, the hormones cannot continue to be made at high levels, and eventually your cycle stops, and that's how we know we're done, because that last cycle is the point of menopause. Okay?
Okay.
That's the short answer.
So let me ask you a question. So you say it's the end of fertility.
Yeah.
So when women are going through it for 15 years, if somebody's 45 and they might start it at 30, so they're done at their fertility might be done, or is that perimenopause?
She said, "Time out."
Okay. I mean, I'm asking.
Flag on the play.
No, you are asking a question with an accurate reflection of the kind of things that you're hearing and seeing online.
Right.
So I'm not poo-pooing any of that.
Okay.
Symptoms are related to the hormonal level and the hormone function.
Okay.
The symptoms, and my analogy to my patients was simply that you're going through withdrawal from high hormone level.
Okay.
But let me take a step back, because when you hit 30, that's when I start crossing my eyes and making faces.
Okay.
Menopause is not the only reason someone could have hot flashes.
Okay.
Menopause is not the only reason that you can have mood changes. You see what I'm saying? The body only has so many different ways of interacting or reacting when things are off balance and out of kilter. Mm-hmm. And we live in a society where there are so many toxins, estrogen-like compounds. There's a lot of stuff going on.
Right.
Let's not even get into stress, poor nutrition. There's so many things going on. Now, there's a subset of women that seem to have an extended amount of time with symptoms, 10 years or more. We're getting more data about understanding that, because some of the studies that have come out the last couple of years suggest that the women who have the most severe vasomotor symptoms, hot flashes or whatnot especially, and the longest, are the ones at the higher risk of cardiovascular disease. Now, what did I say earlier in our conversation? We are already showing risk factors in our early 20s of cardiovascular disease.
Yeah.
Okay? And so the ability to still get pregnant and things like that may not be impaired when women are having early symptoms. Early meaning you're having a bunch of symptoms in your 30s that may be more of a sign that a small incremental decrease in hormones, typically right around that PMS stage, so the last week before the cycle starts, that's when estrogen levels are your lowest. Okay. Progesterone starts falling. So all your hormones, a couple of days before your cycle starts, all of your hormones, estrogen and progesterone, are going to be at their lowest level. It is not unreasonable that if those are starting to inch lower, you start seeing women with symptoms. But there are other things going on to talk about that. Our classic menopause is 3 to 4 years of symptoms as that transition period. Okay, but studies are starting to identify this 10-year mark, this in your 30s mark, and that may have more to do with warning you that cardiovascular disease has already started than it's necessarily warning you that your fertility is at its end. Okay. Is that fair enough?
Yes. That makes sense. Okay.
So when should a woman ask her doctor if she's feeling or experiencing some symptoms to determine if it is something other than menopause where it might be something else? So when's the best time? If you're not going, like, I go to my doctor, I do everything I'm supposed to do yearly, whether it's the primary, the gynecologist, like I'm on it. But when, if a woman is not regularly seeing a physician, when should she seek medical care if something's not right? Is it? I'll let you answer.
I guess I have a couple of parts to that answer.
Okay.
If you're having symptoms that are derailing you, that are interfering with your life, you need to address them.
Okay.
Okay. Hypertension is not something. If you're having symptoms of hypertension, you're way behind the eight ball. There are certain things that are going on that if you're having symptoms, you're way behind the eight ball. Hypertension is one of them. That's why you go on a regular basis for routine preventive care, monitoring type care, to catch those things at a very early stage. Okay? When we talk about menopause, the normal age range, 80%, 85% of women will go through menopause between 45 and 55. If you're 30 and you come in with hot flashes, if you're 65 or 70 and come in with new hot flashes, menopause is not the first thing on my list because you're not the right age range.
Okay.
It's very specifically an age range. Between 40 and 45, another 8% of women, 8 to 10% of women. And when we say go through menopause, we'll have their last cycle. So that's the marker that you had your last period. You don't know it's your last until you've gone a year and not had another one. Okay.
Okay.
And if you're on hormonal contraception, all that is out the window. If you're if you've had a hysterectomy and you don't bleed, or if you had an ablation and you don't bleed, all that's out the window. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So when we talk about spontaneous natural menopause, ages 45 to 55 are that's the natural age range, the normal age range that 80 to 85% of women will have their last cycle. And there's 8 to 10% between 40 and 45. Okay.
Okay.
Earlier than 40 is considered abnormal, and that's less than 1%. We say less than 1%, 1 to 2%. Between 55 and 60, 1 to 2%. Over 60 and still having regular cycles, that increases the risk of endometrial cancer. That needs to be seen. I've seen one patient in my career that insisted that she was still having regular cycles at 62. One patient. I've had probably two that were still having regular cycles at 58-ish. And so we talked about, let's monitor that. So every time women come in on their annual exam, we don't use that term, their well woman visit.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
When was your last cycle? And if it was last month and you're 58, are you still having regular cycles?
Okay. I always yes. wonder why they ask that question every time yes. you have to fill out the paperwork.
Absolutely. Look, I just did a TikTok. I love saying that. They finally convinced me to get on TikTok this year. I've been on Instagram and Facebook and whatnot, but they finally convinced me to get on TikTok this year. Now I get it, because I can be me on TikTok and be silly, yeah. but be real. And so yeah. one of the things that I just posted this week, stop worrying about labels when what's important, how old are you? What's happening with your cycle? And what's your risk of getting pregnant? And the only other thing we really care about is, are you having symptoms of menopause? How do you feel? And are those symptoms derailing you? That's it. As a physician, to be honest, I don't really care what stage of menopause you're in. You're either not in menopause, you're done with it, or you're in the transition. Those are the real, real meaningful pieces.
Okay.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
What day did you start puberty?
Ooh.
What day did you end? We can never say that. We don't know.
Right.
But you know, you don't even remember what day you had your first cycle, but you remember how old you were when you had your first cycle.
That is absolutely right.
Menopause is the same.
Okay.
It's just a transition. It's a transformation. And so we're going to start calling perimenopause your menopause transition. They're okay. starting to really standardize our terminology.
Right.
There is no premenopause. The day I was born, I was premenopausal because I'm a girl.
Mm.
Right.
So that term means nothing to say premenopause.
Mm-hmm.
Perimenopause means you're in that transition. Postmenopause right. means you've had your last cycle. You'll be postmenopausal till the day you die. But guess what? The day I was born, I was postnatal. That means I'm after I was born. I'll be that the rest of my life. The day I delivered my child, I was postpartum. I'll be that the rest of my life, because it just means I delivered a baby.
Right.
Postmenopause just means you had your last cycle. That's it. Now, what's associated with that is what all this is about, but at the end of the day, those labels are not more important than what's actually happening with you as an individual. And that's what I encourage women to really be focused on. Not the label, not the term, what's happening with you.
Right.
Is that fair?
Absolutely.
Right. Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. Right. And I think that's what's the biggest concern is like what's happening with you and
right.
like what's happening to you physically. Right. And yeah. I do think physically is the most important thing, but I think the other part of that is what it's doing to you mentally mm-hmm. and emotionally.
All of it. All yeah. of it. All of it.
Yeah. Right. And then what all happens to it. Me impacts him.
Right.
It does.
Right.
It does.
Right.
And, you know, and it's so funny when, because I have another gentleman that I'm talking to about being on his podcast, because he has a group of men, and I'm actually talking about doing a class, a course or something mm-hmm. specifically for men, for partners of women in menopause.
Right.
To be able to talk about their concerns. But I never hesitate to make it very clear. This is her journey. She's going through a major transformation in all aspects of life, because there are very few tissues in the body that don't have estrogen receptors. And so spending 40 years in high estrogen hormone levels and now transitioning to very low hormone levels because we don't need to support fertility anymore, that is a radical transformation in a small number of years. And so I always center my patient on that, because it's time for her to center herself in life and in general, because she's going to be the best that she can be centering herself and making herself the highest priority. And a big part of that message is that your symptoms, if they're not bothering you, that's one thing. If they're bothering your family, And I got a story about that. That's part of life in terms of, is this being disruptive for you? And certainly more severe symptoms, it is no question it's being disruptive. You can't sleep. You can't think straight. You're not remembering things. You don't want to do anything. You feel horrible. You don't feel like yourself, and you don't even feel like you're in control of yourself. Those are devastating kind of things. I all but cursed out a patient's husband because he said something stupid.
Right.
That was not the first time a husband has said something stupid on any level. And he didn't even say anything even close to the most stupid thing I've ever had a husband say regarding their wife and the care that we're giving and things like that. But when I tell you, I jumped on him so fast, he gasped. And there was a part of me that was just like, you're out of control, Donna. But I couldn't stop myself. And then that voice kept saying, you need to back this up. Because he and I were going at it. You hear me? And that is not me. That is not me. I'm not easily perturbed on any level. Never have been. And so to be screaming back and forth with this guy was ridiculous. But I was out of control. And when I finally was able to walk it back and decelerate that and diffuse it and really kind of apologize to him, which I did, and really kind of bring it back down and bring it out of this man's going to get me, I'm going to get myself sued in a minute. It was that bad.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I was like, ooh, I need to do something about this.
Okay.
And I got on hormones.
I was going to say, so what do you recommend?
I got on hormones at that point.
Okay.
Oh.
Because I needed very rapid, dependable, predictable relief.
Okay.
I had been on herbals years earlier, and I was one of those people with the 10 years worth of symptoms and whatnot. And in the early stages, the herbal stuff worked perfectly for me. I loved it. Loved it. Loved it so much that after 2 or 3 years, I stopped taking it. And I was fine. I was fine. I was feeling great. And then as changes continue, and understand, I wasn't having any changes in my cycle. At some point, my cycle went from every 35 days to every 28 days, but it just did it. And so I started having I used to have 7 days of bleeding. So I used to have 3 to 4 heavy days. Then I had 2 to 3 very rapidly tapering light spotty days, and I was done at day 7. And that happened every 35 days. Then I went to a 5-day cycle that was lighter, that was every 28 days. And I was like, what? is this what a moderate, a light cycle is like? Well, what the hell? I was like, wow. I was loving that.
Yeah.
But the symptoms would come and go. Hot flashes, I stayed hot. But that didn't bother me. My child put on his winter pajamas.
And he was fine.
My thermostat was at 70. And seriously, at work, because I could control the thermostat at work.
Mm-hmm.
I could control the thermostat at home.
Mm-hmm.
And so my environment needed to be cool, very cold. It needed to be cold for me to not have a bunch of hot flashes and feel miserable. Because if I'm hot and miserable, I'm not going to be pleasant to be around. I don't want to be around you. I don't want you to talk to me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want you to look at me. In fact, I don't even want you to think about me. In fact, I don't want you to exist. That's menopause.